Meet Movita Johnson Harrell.
I've really had to fight all my life.
She's a warrior woman going head to head with gun violence.
26 days after my son died, his only child was born.
A powerful voice at rallies and in city council, Movita's battle began after the mother of four moved her family to Delaware County to flee the violence in Southwest Philadelphia. But she learned it wasn't enough.
January 15, 2011, I buried my son.
Movita's youngest, Charles Andre Johnson, was gunned down in Philadelphia in a case of mistaken identity. He was 18.
Devastating. It was devastating.
Because I don't worry about my daughters. I worry about my sons.
Movita, who also lost her father and brother to gun violence, funneled her grief into the Charles Foundation, a nonprofit that supports families of victims of homicide.
I wish these families didn't have to go through this.
Movita and her volunteers fund the effort, helping victims through the process.
The family may need food. They may need help with utilities.
They also work with hundreds of youth most likely to kill and lobby lawmakers for better gun control. Last month, the UPenn educated social worker was named Victim Services Supervisor for the Philly DA's office.
A homicide survivor has never sat in that seat before.
She's hoping more would join the fight.
Movita, there's a lot of people who look at gun violence and say, it's not in my backyard. I don't have to worry about it. What do you say?
There is nobody that's going to come in and save us from this. We have to save ourselves.
Armed with the family's love for a lost son, she's changing the game.
I will
discharge the duties of my office.
Discharge the duties of my office.
With fidelity.
With fidelity.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
I think that it's important for our house to represent the community that it serves. And the visual of me on the house floor gives so many covered women and covered girls hope, right? That they can reach the house and that they can reach their goals, whatever they are. I think what I bring to that district is hope, that they have a champion that will fight for the issues that matter most to them, that they have someone who's been on the front line of the fight for over two decades without worrying about getting a paycheck for doing the work. I care about the people that live in this community, and I'm very, very honored and privileged to be able to serve them.
It is my distinct honor and pleasure to introduce our first speaker tonight, Representative Movita Johnson Harrell. She was elected to serve as state representative for the 190th Legislative District in Philadelphia County on March 12, 2019. She is the first Muslim woman to serve in the Pennsylvania House of Representatives. Her priorities, let's get a round of applause. Her priorities include education reform, economic development in low-income communities, and gun violence prevention. The West Philly native felt the impact of these issues personally when she lost her son to gun violence in 2011. That tragedy inspired her to create the Charles Foundation, a nonprofit founded in her son's name to empower communities and push for more gun violence prevention. Representative Johnson Harrell graduated from the University of Pennsylvania with three degrees. She has worked throughout her career to protect her community. During her time as interim supervisor of victim services in the Philadelphia District Attorney's Office, she worked to create the Crisis Assistance and Response to Empower Survivors model, which raised $1.6 million and produced 15 jobs. Please join me in welcoming Representative Movita Johnson Harrell.
Assalamu alaikum. First and foremost, I want to thank Allah for today and for everything that goes along with today. And secondly, I would like to thank CARE and its board for inviting me and my husband Yancey to celebrate your 23rd anniversary. Please give them a round of applause. So there is a number to text, and there's an envelope on your table. If you have not done so yet, please make a donation to CARE to continue to fund the amazing work that they do to protect civil rights. It's so important that we protect our civil rights. So I'm just going to share myself with you tonight and where I come from and how I've gotten to where I am now, being in the Pennsylvania legislature. I come from five generations of poverty and substance abuse. On Easter Sunday, March 30th, 1975, 9 days before my 9th birthday, my father was shot in front of my family. In that moment, I lost my mother and I lost my only brother. Because my last visual of that evening, March 30th, 1975, was having on a pretty two-piece pink outfit, and in the next moment it was covered in blood. And my last visual of my father alive was him gurgling his own blood as he died in my mother's arms. After that, my mother then began to suffer with severe depression, and she began to self-medicate with drugs and alcohol. My brother at the time was 10 years old. He was 2 years older than me. My brother then began to experience really bad behavioral problems. And they slapped a diagnosis on him of oppositional defiance disorder, which is a diagnosis that they slap on little black boys that they don't know what to do with. My brother then wound up in and out of juvenile facilities and then started self-medicating with drugs and alcohol and wound up in and out of adult correctional facilities. And on July 1st, 1991, my brother was 28 years old. He obviously had mental health issues that had never been properly diagnosed or never properly addressed. At this time, he had custody of his 5-year-old son, and he was homeless. And he was going from house to house, just trying to put a roof over his son's head. And he had gotten a girlfriend and was staying with this girl, and on July 1st, the girl's ex-boyfriend came to the house and told my brother to leave. And as my brother sat tying his 5-year-old shoes, the boy slit my brother's throat. And my 5-year-old nephew watched my brother bleed out in the floor. So tragedy once again struck my family in the form of homicide. And being a child, myself being diagnosed with PTSD and having to grow up very, very quickly because my mother did not have the ability to give me the care that I need. And I had a sister. I had a sister who was 4 years younger than me that I literally had to raise as a child myself. And we struggled. And as I grew up and I got married and I had children, I was always very hypervigilant about violence because of my own experience. So I fought very, very hard to protect my children. I went back to school at 28 years old. First of all, I got clean at 28 years old. On September 15th, I celebrated 25 years in recovery. I then went back to school and I took the test for GED and I scored so high that they gave me a high school diploma and inducted me into a National Honor Society. I then immediately went to school with 4 children and 2 jobs, and I spent 5 years in school, and I graduated in 2004 from the University of Pennsylvania. Now, just take into consideration that I am from West Philadelphia, 5 generations,
And one of the top universities in the nation was not accessible to me as a teenager. But it was accessible to me as an adult. And I took advantage of the opportunities because I wanted to provide better for my children than I'd had growing up. Because let me tell you something, Allah in His infinite mercy and His wisdom will give you what you need to succeed. And He knew that those children would be the catalyst for me to get my life together. Everything I've done in my adult life has been for my children. Because I wanted a better life for my children, because I did not want them growing up in poverty as I had to, because I wanted them to have a mother who was present and available, and because I wanted them safe. In the summer of 2007, my children were 14, 15, 16, and my oldest was up at Indiana University working on her bachelor's degree. She was 20. And my two sons came into my bedroom on that hot July afternoon, and they said to me and my husband that they knew 9 boys murdered in our neighborhood. Now, mind you, at this point, I had graduated from the University of Pennsylvania. I started my own business working in the mental health field because I work to fight for people like my brother. For people with mental illness to be properly diagnosed and properly treated so that they could have a good quality of life. We were that house in the neighborhood. I'm sure you all know there's always one house in the neighborhood that all of the children gravitated toward. We had the big backyard. We rescued dogs. My husband and I would rent 15 passenger vehicles, pack up peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, cram people's kids in, take them up to Atlantic City, to the beach, or to the Poconos, to the mountains. In many instances, this was some of these children's first experience with sand. We were that family because I figured if I could protect the community would protect my children. And when my sons came to me and said, Mom, we know 9 boys murdered, I consoled my sons. I told my sons I would protect them. But when they left my bedroom, I turned to my husband and I said, it's time to go. And less than 6 months later, we packed our family up and moved to Lansdowne, Delaware County, 20-block radius, dry town. Everybody knows everybody's dog's name. And I thought we were safe. And January 12, 2011 was just like any other day. It had snowed that day. And I remember pulling out of my driveway that morning and never turning on the radio, and I had a 45-minute conversation with the law. And I thanked him. Because if you have teenage children, you know they lose their minds at one point, right? So I had this analogy that around 11 or 12, aliens come down from the sky and they suck their brains out through their left ear. And they turn into these people you can't stand. You love them because they're your children, but you know, they get a little flip with the lip and they stomp and they slam doors and they listen to their peers more than they listen to you. And around 18 or 19, the aliens come back down and put their brains back in through their right ears and they start turning into these people that you like again. And that's where we were. We had been through the difficult teenage years. Everyone had come out on the other side. Everyone was where they were supposed to be, and all was well with the world. And on January 12, 2011, at 7 o'clock in the evening, my husband and I were preparing because we've always been very active and involved in the community, and we were preparing to go out to do something, and the 3 children who were home filed into my bedroom. And I told you the type of family that I come from, and I've been able to create the type of family that I always wanted. I always wanted a tight-knit family where we did everything together and we were just so close, and that's what we are. And my children filed into my room, And my youngest Charles was 18 at the time. He stood beside my bedside. My daughter Charlene was 19. She sat in the chair. And my son Dante was 20. He sat on the bed. And something whispered in my ear, get off the bed and hug your kids. And I got off the bed and I wrapped my arms around Charles. He was 6 feet tall, 190 pounds solid. And I kissed his neck and I said, do you know how much your mommy loves you? And he squealed like a little kid. And Charlene, girls take a little longer for the aliens to come back. So, you know, I kissed her and she kind of backed up. But I kissed her and told her how much her mommy loved her. And I kissed my son, Dante. And my husband and I left. And we got home about 8:30, 9 o'clock, and my house was quiet. The children were gone. I had just bought my daughter her first car. It was a bargaining chip. I wanted her back in college full time. And we went to bed at 10 o'clock, and I sat up in my bed at 10:30. And I called Charles's cell phone, and it went to voicemail. And I called Charlene's cell phone, and it went to voicemail. And I called Charlene's best friend, and I told her, tell Charlene get the car home or she'll never drive it again, and I laid back down. And the next time I woke up, it was 11:20, my cell phone was ringing, and my children's pictures are programmed in my phone, so when they call, their pictures pop up. And I see that it's my son, Dante, and I know something's very wrong, because everyone knows not to call me after 10 o'clock. And I pick up the phone, and it sounds like my son's having a panic attack in the phone. And I'm telling him, breathe, Dante, breathe. And he's crying. And he blurts out, Mom, Chuck was shot. Chuck is Charles. And I sit up in the bed, and my husband says, what's wrong? What's wrong? And I just blurt out, Charles has been shot. And my son's crying in the phone, and he says, Mom, he's at Einstein Hospital. You got to get to the hospital, Mom. And I take that drive every morning. It's 45 minutes. My husband gets me to Einstein Hospital in 20 minutes where my son's in surgery. And we're waiting and we're waiting, and after some time, a team of doctors come downstairs, and they're talking, and it sounds like I'm in a Charlie Brown movie, and all I can hear is wah, 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 wah. And I'm saying over and over again, I want to see my son. I want to see my son. And what I did hear was when the doctor said, Mrs. Harrell, your son didn't make it. I cannot believe my legs did not go out from under me. Because in the back of my head, I'm saying they got the wrong kid. They have to have the wrong kid. My son didn't do drugs. He didn't carry guns. He worked full-time caring for over 100 chronically mentally ill people every day. He was engaged to be married. They got the wrong kid. So I'm begging them, you got to take me to see this kid. So they said we have to clean him up first. And after some time, they came downstairs and got me and my husband, and they took us upstairs to an all sterling silver room. And in the middle of this room, on a slab, in a white body bag, zipped up to the neck, was my son. And everything inside of me broke. And they told me I couldn't touch him because it was a homicide investigation. And I walked around this table that seemed to go on forever. And I got to his right ear. And I called the Adhan like I did when he was born. And I recited the Al-Fatiha like I did when he was born. And I kissed his neck that was ice cold. And I said, Charles Johnson, do you know how much your mommy loves you? And they zipped up the bag. And 3 years to the day that I left Philadelphia, I wrapped my son in a white sheet and returned him to Allah. And my life changed forever. In Allah's mercy, I created the Charles Foundation, and I got involved in the gun movement. I found out that my son was murdered in a total case of mistaken identity by two boys
who could not have gotten guns legally. I began to fight for young people on both sides of the gun to make better decisions. So when I ran in 2015-16 for state representative, I did not run because I wanted to be an elected. I ran because I was tired of people that look like me not protecting people that look like me. I ran because I understand that the problem is bigger than the gun. The problem is lack of education. The problem is lack of opportunity. The problem is lack of resources. The problem is food deserts and housing scarcity and how these young people can get a gun faster than they can get a meal. So when I didn't win in 2016, I really wasn't that upset because I was able to change the narrative and I was able to get those same politicians who hadn't done anything to start being more involved in the issues that affect the communities that we care about and that we live in. So when I was tapped in January of this year to run, I had no inkling. I did not want to run. I was where I was and I was doing the work. But you know, one thing I believe in is divine intervention. And one thing that has happened in my life since my son has died is that I have been obedient to a lost cutter. I understand that it's not about me or my life. And people know that I am the first hijabi elected to the Pennsylvania legislature, but that comes with a price. That comes with a price. It comes with a sacrifice to my family. It comes with a sacrifice to my life. I understand I shattered a glass ceiling, and when you shatter glass ceilings, shards are going to come down. But does that mean you don't do it? No. What it means is you bring your true authentic self with you wherever you go. I am not ashamed to be in recovery. I am not ashamed to be a black woman. I am not ashamed to be a hijabi. I am who I am. So when we talk about diversity and inclusion, that means you bring your true authentic self to the table. You are enough. You are good enough. We need to be occupying spaces because nobody's going to speak for us and our communities better than we can do it ourselves. If you saw the day I was sworn in, there was an invocation done and from the podium on the House floor by an evangelist Republican representative. And you know what? I ain't mad at her. I was told from the moment that I got the endorsement from the Democratic Party that I did not belong. I was told that I was not worthy. In the 7 months that I have been in office, I get hate mail. I get death threats. I have been told I'm only getting one term. You know what? I got there by divine intervention. I'm going to leave by divine intervention. And this is why organizations like CARE is so important to protect our rights. Yes, give them a round of applause. And if you are in this room and you represent your community and you represent a pocket that does not have a seat at the table, you must remember, if you are not at the table, then you are on the menu. We can no longer afford to be on the menu. With the pandering of white supremacy in this country today, we can no longer afford to be on the menu. And if you are at the table and it's people that only look like you, you need to make room at the table and include some others at that table. So
So I am so grateful to be here. I am so grateful to be here with you tonight. I am so grateful to be the first Hadja in the Pennsylvania legislature ever. I just ask that you continue to make dua for me and my family. I ask that you continue to stand firm in your authenticity and your truth. And I ask that you continue to represent those that are not represented. Thank you.